sing. Through you the mute will sing. Through you the dead will rise. Through you all hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. I am free. I am free to run. I am free to run.
Continue to worship with us as we sing this old hymn.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner. There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear? Joy, I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
In the valley that I wander, turn to
my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Stop your feet till you find that gospel, because he's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. Clap your hands and stomp your feet till you find that gospel, because he's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need.
I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful.
I got an old church choir singing in my soul.
I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful.
I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
Walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. You feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom to save it. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found all run to things we know just ain't right. When there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaker.
With us.
If you believe it, if you receive it,
You can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify.
One more time.
If you believe it, if you receive it, testify. You got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, the savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Get up,
you need freedom. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker.
Everybody say amen.
In Luke 6, verse 38, Jesus says, "Give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back." Jesus is saying to His followers, and this is Luke's version. It's tucked away in Luke's version of the Sermon on the Mount. And the thing that's interesting about this verse is the verse that comes right before it. And often when we quote Luke 6:38, we don't go back to verse 37. But I want you to see 38 in the context of verse 37, because it brings an interesting shade of meaning to what Jesus is saying in this particular verse. Without a doubt, He's saying that we are called to be generous people who are depending upon the hand of God to provide for us. And that we are not to be people who hoard our resources unto ourselves, but we need to be those who are looking for another opportunity to help someone on their way, even if it costs us something, and really it should cost us something if love is involved. But look at verse 37 and look at, again, the shade that it brings to this verse 38. Jesus says, "Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. And then give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." And when I look at that passage of Scripture, I hear Jesus calling us as His followers to be a giving people, giving indiscriminately to those who are around us who have need. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean that when you take that verse 37 and you couple it together with verse 38, Jesus starts out and says, don't judge people. Just love people. That's what He's saying. Don't decide, are they worthy of the gift that I'm going to give them? But just give, because God has bestowed within your life the resources and the opportunity to make a difference in someone else's life. Jesus doesn't say, find people who are right in the middle of the pathway that I would have them to walk and then give it to them. He doesn't say that. He says, don't judge people. Don't decide about people. Don't decide about their worthiness. Folks, guess what? If God had decided about our worthiness, Jesus' blood would have no effect when it comes to our salvation. Because the truth is, none of us are worthy of that blood that was shed. If you agree with that theologically, say amen. Amen. We're not worthy of the blood, but we need the blood. And there are times when people are not worthy of the kindness that's being extended to them, but God would have us to extend that kindness to them because it is an opportunity for them to experience the light of His love in their lives. Sometimes people just need to be surprised that we've loved them. Sometimes they need to be left scratching their heads wondering, why would they do that for me? Man, if they knew how I live my life. They wouldn't have given that to me. Give. Every opportunity you have, give. I want to thank the missions committee for a number of years now. We are challenged at this time of year to buy a bag of rice, or two or three or 10 or 20, you know. One year I came in and a fella pulled up in his pickup truck and he brought in a big box of 1 pound bags of rice. And I said, wow. And he said, well, man, you know what? He said, and at that time, he said, that each bag of rice cost me a dollar. And he said, if me spending a dollar for a bag of rice is going to go toward helping a family to have a complete Thanksgiving meal, man, count me in. And y'all, that's what that's about. Other churches in the area through United Ministries are giving other items. We were signed up to be the rice people. Pray for the ones that are the turkey people. Lord, that church has got to have a freezer out in the foyer, you know? But praise the Lord for them. We could be the stovetop dressing people, you know? But the thing is, as the body of Christ in Sumter, as we all participate, and these items are taken to United Ministries. And they put it all together. And Thanksgiving baskets, if you will, or a box with everything that's needed for a Thanksgiving dinner is delivered to households who are in need. That's the kind of thing Jesus is talking about. I mean, is that not a simple thing? I went to IGA, Blue Ribbon Rice. Y'all, I cannot cook rice. I've tried, now I can do it in the rice cooker. That little pot, you know, but I've tried to do it on the stove and it never turns out. Oh, and I can do some brown rice. Rice. Putting that box out there and taking to United Ministries, that bag of rice says, Jesus, I love you and I love the people around me. 85 cents. What? And 20 some years ago, Mark Cox came to us and said, hey, what do you think about us getting involved in Operation Christmas Child? For you Air Force and military people, OCC. You like those abbreviations, don't you? Operation Christmas Child. You take a shoebox, and when we started, we actually took shoeboxes. Remember, they didn't have these yet. When we started, you'd take a shoebox. And some people, man, they get excited and come in with like a boot box. And what? That kid was going to have Christmas, you know what I'm saying? But then they started providing these boxes. And we just order them, they send them to us. And there's a little pamphlet inside, and it tells you everything to do. And you put it all together, and you put $9 with each box. And you can even go online now and pay your $9 and then track the box, see where it goes and what area of the world it goes to. And these things go all over the world. I mean, just millions of boxes. And used to be you could put anything in there, you know. And now they've got a select list. Don't put liquid items. Don't put chocolate. You never were supposed to put guns and implements of war that represented warfare. But, you know, now they say don't put toothpaste or any of that. But you can put a toothbrush and you can put a wow item in there. Maybe a little stuffed animal or what? What is this all about? Well, it's not just about these little presents. It's about what happens when they make distribution of these boxes. Oh, and by the way, you may not have known this, but they take these boxes to Charlotte or Boone, somewhere up in North Carolina, and they actually go through and rework the boxes so that they're equitable. In other words, they want to make sure that all the kids are getting the same, you know, the same, value, if you will, when it comes to the gift box, because you don't want these two kids in a village in Africa somewhere, one opens it up and it's like, oh, wow. And the other one opens it up and says, oh, wow. So they take care of that. But these boxes are a means to go into an area to share the gospel. Because every kid that gets a shoebox also gets a gospel tract put out by Samaritan's Purse that shares the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that gospel ends up being shared not only with that kid, but with that family. And every child and every member of the family not only has an opportunity to respond to the gospel, but has an opportunity to sign up and be a part of a discipleship class in their area, in their language, for 12 weeks. Y'all, this is the best bargain that I know of to get involved with and to give an opportunity for every one of us to reach the world for Christ. Jesus said, go into the world and make disciples of all nations. And this is an opportunity as we join hands with Samaritan's Purse, Billy Graham organization, to reach into the world with the gospel of Christ and to share some love. To have a, isn't it awesome to realize that we can be a part of a kid having a Christmas gift who might not otherwise have a Christmas gift? I mean, it's just an incredible opportunity. And there's only, with this box, I think, and the ones that are left out, there's only 16. A number of you have already taken them, but we want all, the rest of the 16 boxes to go today, okay? Now, here's another opportunity that they're extending. For you who would rather not go to the store and buy the items. Oh, and by the way, you know, I'm just going to tell you just as a matter of example. So I'm telling you what I did. The Bible says if I tell you what I did, that's my reward. So I am forfeiting my reward to tell you from a leadership position what I did and what it involved. Got a box for me and a box for Becky, and I went to the dollar store, and I bought a stuffed animal that would fit in the box for each one, and I bought a writing tablet, and I bought some crayons, and I bought toothbrush and a comb for each box. I bought a Hot Wheels for each box. I bought a couple of other items that are escaping me right now, but just a mix of items that I put in there. And it cost me, with the items I purchased, $42, and with $9 a box, I am impacting two kids in this world that I will not see until the other side for $60. And that $60 for two shoe boxes is laying up treasures in heaven. Is that not incredible? We'll go to Outback for lunch today. And Outback has got something going on. I don't care if you get a ribeye or you get a hamburger. They're going to get $40 or $50 out of you. What? Beck and I look at each other. We're like a couple of kids, you know. What are you drinking? Is it all right if I get a Diet Coke? Or do I need to get water? I mean, you get two waters instead of two Diet Cokes, you done saved $5, $6 right there. And I'm going to tell you what, I'm going to get one to go. You know what I'm saying? If I get that Diet Coke, you better go ahead and get that big to-go cup out. I'm taking one home if I'm going to pay that. But anyway, and we go eat it out back, and we'll spend almost as much as we spent for these two boxes, and it ain't laying up treasures in heaven. If I don't take my stomach pill, it's going to keep me up all night. I'm telling y'all, this is a bargain. And I don't know if you've ever gotten involved, but man, I encourage you to do that. In 2009, I made my second trip to Haiti, and we took gifts for the kids who were there, a part of that village, and a lot of them are orphans. And we handed out gift bags to the kids on Sunday afternoon, the week that we were there. And y'all, I cried like a baby as those kids came forward to pick up their little gift bag. They took like a little gift bag, and they just distributed all the gifts we brought, and then we had an opportunity to actually hand a bag to a kid. And I thought, Lord, what an incredible thing to be able to do something that really cost me so very little, but meant so very much in a child's life. And what I started to tell you before and got sidetracked, for those of you who are online people, you can actually go online to Samaritan's Purse, Operation Christmas Child, and you can give a box online and never have to go to Walmart. Huh? Hallelujah. I mean, you can go on there and build a box and pay it online, and, you know, and boy, I know you millennials and younger folks, that is like jackpot for y'all. That's how you like to do things. And so anyway, they've accommodated that. In 1980, I was associate pastor at First Church of God in Columbia. And the church, the brotherhood of that church, they were the ones who were responsible for Thanksgiving baskets, gift baskets. And Brother Jackson was the preacher, and he just kind of headed it up with the brotherhood. And so guys would donate money, or they would donate items, and we would put together these gift boxes, and they would have everything that they needed for a Thanksgiving meal. And we did it, you know, it wasn't just a bag of rice. We didn't do it through a cooperative effort like we're able to do here in Sumter. So we, you know, we had the turkey and all the fixings and put it all in there. Had sweet potatoes so they could make pecans, brown sugar so they, you know, they can make sweet potato casserole. Why do we only make that once a year? But anyway, they everything in the box for them to put together a Thanksgiving meal. And so each of us would deliver, had responsibility for delivering a couple of boxes. And I think we sent out 50 that particular year, as I remember. And I was given two houses close by to where the church was located. And so I went to the first house and I delivered a box, and they were very grateful. Names were just handed in. I don't know who decided that these were the people, but names just came to us. And the second house I went to, and y'all, it was November, but it was one of those South Carolina days. I mean, you could wear a t-shirt and flip-flops that day. Just a beautiful day. And so as I went up to the door of this second house, it was an African-American family, and they had a screen door. I'm talking about the old screen door, you know, with the spring. You know what I'm talking? I mean, don't you slam that door. They let that door go and, you know, it slapped the door frame. And so I go up and I knock on the door, and I heard the mama ask one of the kids who had run out to see who this was. I heard her ask, "Who is it?" "Some white man." And so she came to the door. "How can I help you?" And I said, "Well, are you so-and-so?" "Yeah." And I said, "Well, I've got a Thanksgiving basket for you. Is it all right if I bring it?" And she said, "Oh, thank you so much." And so I went to my car and I got the box and I carried it. And they had even put some little toys in there for the kids. There were three kids. And they were all elementary age, like starting at 8 down to like 3. Y'all, the woman thanked me for the basket. I set it on the table in the living room, the coffee table. And I said, "May I have a prayer with you?" And I said a prayer with them. And then she thanked me and I went on my way. And I went out that screen door and bam, behind me. And the middle child, I can't remember how old, but the middle child came to that screen door on that sunny November morning and looked as I was walking away, and I heard that child say, "Mama, was that Jesus?" I was a wreck. And it framed life for me in that moment. I mean, it did. I thought, man, how easy it is to extend some grace and some love to people. And we didn't go in and say, you know, are you deserving of this? We didn't go in and say, well, you know, you got cable TV. Why in the world should you get this box? I mean, we could do it that way. And sometimes we do. But remember, before Jesus said, give, and it will be given to you, before He said that, He said, do not judge. I wonder sometimes, that's been a lot of years ago, 1980. I wonder sometimes if I'll bump into that family on the streets of gold. I just wonder, you know. I wonder if I'll have the opportunity to see that child over there on the other side as together we sit down at the feet of Jesus. Oh, I'm no Jesus. I'm far from it. And I'm sure the mama said, no, that's not Jesus, but do you ever feel better than when you do something that Jesus would do? Are you with me? I never feel better than when I just simply do something like Jesus would do. And Jesus said, whatever you do for the least of people, you're really doing it for me. Doing it for Jesus. Jesus is saying, if you want to love me, love those around you. Can you imagine? I'm wondering what's Thanksgiving going to be like this year, you know? They're already saying that maybe we shouldn't have these family gatherings and what have you. But I got to tell you, there was a time, but it's been a long time, since Becky and I have worried about how are we going to buy the groceries for Thanksgiving. Are we not blessed people? I mean, we just go... The only negative when we go shopping for Thanksgiving is Walmart is always out of beef broth and consomme. And there goes the brown rice. And then you got to go all over town to try to find the beef broth and the consomme, you know? And you go through and, you know, Beck, she'll shop in shifts for Thanksgiving. She'll go and she'll come back and she'll say, well, spent $123 today for Thanksgiving. How many people we having, Beck? She'll go another day, she'll come back. Well, I spent $84 today for Thanksgiving. And we don't worry about it. We add casseroles. I don't know why we fix all those casseroles. Beck, are you listening to me back there? She's back there, y'all. I mean, just keep adding casseroles. And we don't worry about it. And there are people all around us in Sumter who wonder how in the world they're going to have Thanksgiving dinner. I want to be a part of them having Thanksgiving dinner. There are people wondering how in the world they're going to have Christmas for their kids this year. And I want to be a part of making sure those kids have Christmas. And I want them to have Christmas even if their mom and dad's wasted the money that they should have been saving for their Christmas presents. Are you with me? You hear my heart? Jesus said in Matthew 10:42, if you give even a cup of cold water to one of the least of my followers, you will be rewarded. Lay up treasures in heaven. What are those treasures? Paul said in one of his letters to one of the churches, he said, "You are my joy and my glory in eternity." There it is. It's not like there's a bank account up there, and if you tithe this much, it's going to show up there, and there's your treasures in heaven. Uh-uh. What Jesus is talking about is when we love people in the name of Christ for their good and for the glory of God, when they are walking those streets of gold, there is our treasure in heaven. There it is. Certainly Jesus is our treasure, but I'm telling you that when you step over to the other side and you bump into people who are there because of your generosity and because of your love and because of your witness, give. And it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. For years, I've been seeing those commercials for St. Jude's Hospital. And I'll watch those ads, and I know they're real, don't you? They're real. That's not stage stuff. I mean, that's real life. Parents doing everything they can to get their kids to where they can overcome an illness that is threatening their child's life. I watch those commercials, and I think, I'm going to do that and never do it. And last month I saw the commercial and I said, you know what? I'm not just going to say it. And that's a cool thing about that iPhone. I took that iPhone while I'm sitting right there and I said, I'm doing this. And I signed up, and every month, just a little bit. I'm not a huge donor. My name's not going to be on any plaque anywhere. But every month there's a little bit going to St. Jude's Hospital. Every month there's a little bit going to World Vision for Abe, a six-year-old in Africa, Ethiopia, that Becky and I have adopted. And $39 a month provides that child with an educational and health care opportunity. That's unbelievable to me. I'm going to spend more than that when I go to Outback today for lunch, even if I eat a hamburger. Now, I know I told you before, Jesus said, if you do your works to be seen of man, you've gotten your reward. So Jesus, I'm just saying it because it's got to be that real for us, that we understand how privileged we are. And the Bible says, to whom much is given, much is required. In other words, God has blessed us that we might be able to be a blessing to those around us. A bag of rice in Sumter, a shoebox going across the world are all opportunities for us to populate heaven, for us to show the love of Jesus, and to have some child ask his or her mama, was that Jesus? Was that Jesus that just brought that box here and left it? I never feel better than when I do something that I know my Lord would do if He were there in physical presence. So that's what was on my heart today to share. Help us all, Lord, this time in our lives to listen to what Your Spirit speaks to us. We are so blessed. It It's hard to believe, Lord, that there are people who don't even know what they're going to put on the table for their family at the next meal, just struggling by. And some of those people have gotten themselves into that trouble. But Lord, who has not gotten themselves in trouble? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Lord, I pray that you would help us to examine people less and to love them more. Father, that we would see the gifts that we're able to extend as an opportunity for people to cross over from where they've been to where you would have them to be. Maybe, Lord, we could love someone in such a way this week and they don't even know it's us giving, like with these shoeboxes. We don't know who's going to get our shoebox. We don't even know, unless we track it, what part of the world it will end up in. But Lord, what if because we lovingly became involved, some child somewhere this year accepts Jesus as Savior, giving us the opportunity to know them in eternity as we all sit together at your feet. Oh Lord, thank you. Thank you for loving us the way you do. And thank you, Lord, for pouring into our lives a love for others that we know is from you, because we weren't like that before you showed up in our lives. We only cared about ourselves. But the longer we walk with you, Jesus, the more we care about the people who are around us, and even those who are halfway around the world. And oh Lord, I confess to you and my family here this morning that when I heard about the earthquake in Izmir, having lived there as a kid for 2.5 years as an army brat, Lord, my heart went out to the people of Izmir, who in a moment's time had the solid ground beneath them turned into rubble. Lord, help us to understand the uncertainties that have put so many people at disadvantage. Maybe we could be love in their pathway. Maybe we could be light in their darkness. Maybe we could be hope in their despair. Thank you, Lord, for what this church does year after year and month after month. Missionaries being supported, 4 missionaries being supported, Lord, because of the giving of this church. Church of God ministries being supported, state ministries being supported, United Ministries being supported, Pregnancy Center being supported, so many things that we're a part of. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Operation Christmas Child, Bag of Rice. Thank you, Lord. Make it count. Make it count for eternity, we pray. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. How you love me. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed.
Voices.
Lord, I'm amazed by you.